Tonight we've gathered to hear a story. It's a story that's shown by simplicity. It's not an exciting story at all, not when you look at the surface. Story of a birth and an announcement. But like I said just a little while ago, this story changed the course of the universe. It's the hinge on which all time turns. But on a very personal level, it's a story of our redemption. Because through this story, we have been saved. So friends, prepare to hear the story of Bethlehem.
Just need a hand once in a while.
Just a steady.
Steady.
Thank you. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given. And the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. Upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. You know, the amazing thing to consider as we hear this beginning is that hundreds of years before it even happened, Isaiah talked about a child who was going to be born, who would absolutely change the world. He would change everything. The prophet said that this child would be received as the bringer of peace and the bringer of justice and the bringer of righteousness. Isaiah, in his wisdom as a prophet, gave hope for the light to come. Yet while he lived, he was very likely considered just another old fool or visionary, an old man dreaming dreams. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And his kingdom, it will have no end." And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has regarded the lowly estate of his handmaiden. For behold, henceforth all generations will call me blessed, for he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And his mercy is on those who fear him from generation to generation." You see, many, many years after Isaiah lived, we start seeing some of the events that he predicted unfold. Mary has been chosen to be the mother of Jesus Christ. And she has accepted that role with grace and with dignity. But I want you to imagine. I want you to imagine what this young woman must have felt. I mean, can you imagine the emotions that must have been stirring up within her when she was visited by an angel and told that she was going to have a child? And it was not going to be an ordinary child, but the one who was going to be called the Son of God. You know, I can't imagine the anxiety she must have felt as she considered how she was going to tell all these things to Joseph, the man she was to marry.
Mary, do you know that your baby?
Now, the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, took place in this way. When his mother, Mary, had been engaged to Joseph, but before they had lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband, Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." You know, when the angel visited Joseph in a dream telling him that Mary was going to have a child of the Holy Spirit, Joseph too accepted his own place in this drama that was playing out before him. But I want you to imagine his feelings as he was beginning his married life under, let's just say, trying circumstances. Knowing that his family life would be unusual and out of the ordinary, to say the least. He must have wondered what he was going to say to Mary and others about her condition. He must also have had this overwhelming feeling of inadequacy, of unworthiness, as at being chosen to be the Messiah's earthly father. Considering all this, what a compassionate and thoughtful man Joseph must have been, accepting and performing the role with unselfishness and grace and understanding. Let's sing together. Two verses from "What Child Is This?" In those days, a decree went out from Caesar, Augustus, that all the world should be enrolled. This was the first enrollment when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be enrolled, each to his own city. Now, we can almost see her. Mary, 9 months pregnant, jostling along on the back of a donkey, being pulled by Joseph through all these crowds because there were a tremendous number of people coming into Bethlehem, jostling and pushing their way through all those folks who had come to be enrolled. And we can only imagine Mary's discomfort. Now, there's no record that she complained of the traveling or faced the uncertainty or as she faced the uncertainties of the road, but I have to believe that it was a less than pleasant trip. Trip must have also been horribly difficult for her. Joseph, too, must have suffered with concern for both his wife and his unborn child. The bustling town of Bethlehem, otherwise a small little town, enlarged by all these people, must have been a welcome sight to them. I just wonder if they could have been aware of the even more uncertain journey they would be beginning with this child. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the city of Nazareth to Judea to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be enrolled with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. You know, a busy marketplace can be both exciting and very frustrating. And I'll tell you, for Mary and Joseph, it must have been both. Now, under normal circumstances, it might be exciting to wander around, to taste the different foods, maybe to visit with some old friends they hadn't seen in a while, or even to sell some of Joseph's handiwork, his wood-carved wares. But to have no choice other than to push through crowds as she rode on a donkey, stand in line for hours at the enrolling place and pay taxes too, that was not a positive thing for this couple. All of this must have made the experience in Bethlehem more frustrating than it was exciting. Let's sing together the first two verses of What Child Is This? Or A Song in the Air. And while they were there, the time came for her to be delivered. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Now, let me ask you, have y'all ever been on a long trip, traveled a great distance to just get a few more miles down the road? Have you ever done that? Sure. And then when you finally get so tired you don't want to go any further, you decide to stop. But when you decide to stop, there's a no vacancy sign on motel after motel after motel. So you're forced to keep traveling. Now, you remember how you felt when that happened? You were tired, you were irritated, you were angry. Miranda's nodding. You were frustrated, right? Willing to take any room at any price, regardless of what Clyde says. You know, Joseph must have known those feelings too. The need for a place to stay was made even more desperate because Mary's time was close. So maybe a simple stable. Maybe that was a welcome sight for the night. I mean, it was warm, it was sheltered, it was away from the crowded, noisy town. Here, in the simplicity of a stable, Mary's baby was born. And she made a bed for him on some straw, there in a manger. Mm-hmm. And in that region, there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over their flocks by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with fear. And the angel said to them, "Be not afraid. For behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will come to all people. For to you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom he is pleased." No, this birth was not going to be a quiet one, celebrated by a few family and friends. It was announced in grand style by not just one, but by a whole choir of angels singing a majestic chorus. They were singing to the shepherds out there watching their sheep. Those angels captured for all time the glory and the wonder and the importance of the birth, which took place in a stable there in a small town called Bethlehem. When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." You know, I've got to believe those shepherds must have been, they must have been shaken in their boots, or maybe better, their sandals. In spite of the angel's calming assurance that there was nothing to fear, how overwhelming it must have been to witness this supernatural event. Yet their curiosity was stronger than their fear, because they left the field at once and went to Bethlehem and then went to the stable. And you know, we can imagine how their curiosity turned to wonder when they found a child just as the angels said they would. Imagine what those simple men, and they were incredibly simple men, imagine what they must have thought when they found the promised Messiah laying on a bed of hay in an animal's feeding trough. Let's sing together the first two verses of hymn 155, "Angels from the Realms of Glory." And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying which had been told them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary kept all these things, pondering them in her heart. Now, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him." Now, just like the shepherds heard the voice of the angel, the Magi followed a star, riding their camels for days, carrying their precious gifts. Now, this was a fulfillment for them of the prophecy and the hope of the coming of the new king in the line of David. This they knew. Now, I want you to imagine their wonder in finding this child that they knew carried divinity and royalty within himself, found him in a stable there in a manger. Yet they didn't doubt this, that this was indeed the one that Isaiah prophesied. Nor did they hesitate to present him with their precious gifts. And those gifts were gold and frankincense and myrrh. Then, satisfied that this child was the one that they'd expected, they went back to their far countries to the east, taking with them the message of his birth with all the wonder and all the joy and all the promise that it contained. But it was for Mary. It was for Mary that they felt the most emotion. We're talking about a young woman far away from her family in a strange and difficult place, giving birth to her first child. She knew that the child was going to be different, that his destiny had yet not been revealed. She didn't know it. But imagine her feelings when the shepherds appeared, followed by the kings and angels all around. A birth itself is overwhelming. We know that. But Mary also had these other unnatural occurrences to consider and to deal with. She knew that she had given birth to a very special child who would be known as Prince of Peace, Wonderful Counselor, Emmanuel, the long-awaited Messiah. How difficult it must have been for her to realize that her son was Jesus the Christ. But we can only assume that that's what she was thinking. Because all we're told is that Mary kept all these things, all these thoughts, all these emotions within herself, and she pondered them in her heart.
Thank you.
And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and singing, as it had been told them. On this night, we, like the shepherds, return to this place to glorify God and give praise for the birth and life of Mary's son. We, like the angels, keep music in our hearts and sing the familiar and well-loved songs to remind us of that night long ago in Bethlehem. And perhaps, just for a little while, we can turn off the Christmas tree lights and ignore all the glitter and the tinsel and forget about the wrapped presents under the tree. And remember with all our hearts and our minds the most precious gift of all, God's Son, Jesus Christ. Let's remember his birthday with these gifts: our promise to help bring peace and to bring justice and to bring righteousness to all the corners of the earth. Then truly the angels' music will fill the heavens again, and the world will be filled with the glory of God in the highest, and on earth, peace. Amen. Together, let's sing hymn 139, Go Tell It on the Mountain. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things through him came into being, and apart from him, nothing came into being. That which came into being in him was life, and the life was the light of humanity. The light of the darkness shines, and the darkness did not overcome it. He was in the world, and the world through him came into being, and the world didn't know him. To his own he came, and his own didn't accept him. But all who accepted him He gave to them the ability to become the children of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw His glory, glory as the firstborn from the Father, full of grace and truth. Because from His fullness we all receive even grace upon grace. You see, according to the evangelist John, in the beginning was the one who was called the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was truly God. The Word was with God and was there at the very beginning. And all things that were made through the Word. There was nothing created that did not come from Him. Everything that He created received its life from Him. And His life gave light to everything and everyone. And the light keeps shining in the dark. And the darkness, well, it can't overcome the light. Let's all sing together. Silent Night, Holy Night, and please stand. You see, on a Christmas night, long time ago, the light entered the world. And the light entered the world through the simplicity of a manger. A child crying in the darkness, and a mother offering him comfort. His coming was first announced. Well, his first visitors were shepherds, not men of power and prestige, but very common folk. And through the centuries, this light has been in our world, illuminating the walk people can take, guiding their direction, offering them peace as they looked in the past and hope as they focused on the future. Now, there have been times, though, when this light, men tried to extinguish the light. They tried very hard, and it appeared that there that light might be put out. If you could, as carefully as you can, just put your candles down behind a pew, because that's what men have tried to do for centuries. But in spite of their best efforts, since the light isn't controlled by us, it continues to grow in a world that desperately needs light. Help us as men and women continue to convey it. Tonight you've heard the story of Christmas. That's what it is. But like the angels announced, let us announce it as well. Parents and grandparents, tell your children about it. Children, tell your friends about the story of Christmas. How the entire world changed at the birth of one child. Amen. Brothers and sisters, as God's people, go now in peace. Amen.